Good morning, Monticello Christian Church family. Welcome to our online worship service. Let's begin our time together with a word of prayer. Lord of mercy and of abundant love, we have gathered here this day to hear your healing words of compassion and to be transformed by your love. Help us to become more faithful servants in our thoughts, words, and in our deeds. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Carry before the Lord our prayers and concerns for ourselves and those that we know. God of justice and righteousness, your call beckons to us to live lives of faith and faithful lives, to turn from wickedness, to walk in your ways. Yet it is so easy for us, we confess, to turn aside, to speak a thoughtless word, to ignore those in need, to strike out in anger, to forget your ways. Lord, forgive us, we pray. Implant your word in our hearts and cleanse us from all evil. Today we seek to lift before you those on our church prayer list, to lift up those on our hearts as well as to set ourselves before you. We humbly ask that you would restore us in relationship to one another and to you, and that we might, in full knowledge of our sins, grant them unto you for forgiveness and to receive from your bounty all that we have and be grateful. We set this all before you, Lord, in the silence of our hearts now. By the power of your love, save our soul that we might faithfully serve you. We pray this in Jesus' name, for it was he who taught us to pray this prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. May you know that you are God's beloved children, and may you in this time look into one another's face and see the beauty of God's creation. Share the Lord's peace with gladness, as you offer signs and words of peace to one another. And may the peace of God be always with you. Amen.
Thank you.
On the night before his betrayal, Jesus Christ took bread, and after giving thanks to God for it, he broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take this, all of you. This is my body, which is broken for you, and as often as you shall eat of it, do so in remembrance of me." He then took the cup, gave thanks to God for it, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood, which is shed for you, and as often as you shall drink of it, do so in remembrance of me." As we today partake in communion, let us remember the one who faced the worst kinds of suffering so that we might know his perfect love and his unchanging faithfulness. Let us remember the one who chose to die so we could draw near to him in our pain and in our joy. Let us remember Jesus, who gave everything so we would never be alone or rejected as he was, not even in our darkest nights. May we also give of our tithes and offerings, knowing that every generous act of giving, as with every perfect gift, is from above. May God's word of truth bloom in acts of loving faithfulness, and may the word shape our lives that we become not only hearers but doers of the word, using all of God's good gifts. Let us ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name as we bring our offerings into his courts this day. Amen. Scripture passage this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, beginning at the first verse. "Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets, to be honored by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your right hand know what your left hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. When you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show others their fasting. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that it will not be obvious to others that you're fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. This is the word of God for you, the people of God. We continue in our series focusing on this, the Sermon on the Mount. As we've seen, there is this great unifying structure to this sermon as Christ was delivering this, not in soundbite sections, but as one great message over the course of all kinds of areas and examples. And so we would seek to not have this portion of scripture summed up for us, but that we would head up to the summit and sit at the feet of Jesus as he delivers the Sermon on the Mount in this series, Sum It Up. I met my wife in drama class. We each took 3 years of drama, even though initially the school only had drama one and drama two. They offered a third option of speech two, and we both opted to take it. And this was before we even began dating. In that class, the three semesters that we took it, we had a part to play, as is the nature of anyone who takes a drama class. She played parts such as an evil stepsister and so on. And I played parts like Igor and Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer and Jack, the roughneck, rough and tumble, sleeveless, flannel shirt wearing kid with a heart of gold. I even played Baptista from Taming on the Shrew, Taming of the Shrew. Now, when we were playing those parts, would it be correct to say that we were hypocrites? I mean, would someone have stood up in the crowd and said, "Hey, that guy's not a real hunchback," or, "Hey, this guy right here, he's not really seeking a husband for his daughter, Catherine. Hey, that guy's not a shaggy, baggy clothes wearing loner who's a lover and not a fighter." Well, that's where you'd be wrong, because that's exactly who I was in high school. But no, we weren't being hypocrites. And we were actually living the definition of what a hypocrite is. A hypocrite was a word that is a word that has been drawn from the word for a Greek actor on a stage, someone who is pretending. And so to act is to live out what a hypocrite is, but our understanding of what we use that word for now is much different. But in its source, it means to make believe, which is important. Studies show that make-believe in children is actually healthy. But when we hear that word now, it is not a healthy situation. It's when we misrepresent ourselves as something we are not. And unfortunately, that is a word that is most often in discourse applied to Christians. When asked non-Christians why they don't attend church, and more specifically, when they ask people who were in church but don't go anymore, it's because they say that they're all hypocrites there. They misrepresent themselves as something that they are not. And when we do so, my friends, what we do is harm. It's a great deal of harm. We do no one any favors, not to ourselves and not to God, because we bring harm on ourselves. We bring harm on our faith and those who are fellow members of this faith. And most importantly, we bring harm before God. And so in our passage today, we see Jesus repeatedly pointing out, don't be like the hypocrites. Don't be like those who portray themselves as more holy than they are, as more pious than they are. We need to be who we are and be genuine about who we are as people who are seeking to be Christ-like. We aren't always successful in that. But to be earnest in our desire, in our journey, in our quest to look at Jesus and have him as the heading of this road and to follow him. And when we fail and fall, to be honest, When we are deceitful, to be honest about it. When we get it wrong, to be honest about that. To make amends when we hurt someone's feelings, to be honest about it. And specific instances that we see in this passage is in giving and is in prayer and is in fasting. And that the hypocrites do it for others. When they give, they don't give for those that they're giving to. They give that others might see and think them to be one thing or another. And when they pray, they don't do so as a conversation, a dialogue between God and themselves. They do it that others might see it. And when they fast even, they do it that others might see. So I ask you, why do we give? As Christians, you and I, why do we give? Why do we pray? Why do we fast? Not only why, as a theoretical understanding of why we have these practices in the church, but why do you and I do it? What's our motivations? What is our intentions? Intentions, see, in this, we've seen in this sermon have as an undercurrent of what the whole purpose of the sermon is. What is our intentions? What are we seeking to be in this world? Are we giving so that we can say, look how generous, i.e. rich, I am. Look how holier than thou I am. Look how I seek to decrease my ego. No, look how I seek to decrease my waistline. What is the motivation and intention of giving and praying and fasting and so many other things that we do that our pride and our flesh and our will seeks to place before others? In this world, 21st century, we have a greater temptation to do so because we live in an Instagram world where this that you see before you has become a opportunity to show people things about yourself that you can then place through a filter. That you can place with a veneer of holiness, and you can put little words here, there, and everywhere to hint and guide people, Bible verses and everything. And if you don't get it right, you can go back and do it again, and you can cut out and do all of this. And then the world sees you and me as having it all together, as holy and pious people, but my friends, we're broken. Who we are isn't in this. Who we are is this. And do we do what we do that others might see and think of us something that we're not? Again, we see this rich illustration in this passage that we've seen before in this series of abstaining from living as hollow people. What is inside of us? What is the motivation of what we're doing? Are we doing what we are doing so that others, that the world, that flesh have its way? Or are we doing something for God? Exterior behavior with no internal intention or motive to love and serve God and other people. Is this why we give? To solely deal with the outside rather than what's inside? Do we pray? Do we fast because of something that has no intention or motive to love and serve God and other people? From last time, we see a two sides of a coin. From last time to this time, we see a turning from a focus of outward to inward, that there is something internal about these things. Even though we are directed and caution from the outside, that we're directed inside as opposed to last time, rather than having something that begins inside and goes outward, dealing with the flesh, or with the spirit, it should be something that is from without going in. Our giving may have its intention of funds to someone who is in need, or services to someone who is in need, but really we do so not that the world would see, but that God would be honored in what we're doing, and so on. This temporal relationship from last week has moved to the spiritual. And so the care of others' faith and our faith as it relates to others was last week, where now we see the care of our faith and faith as it relates to God. We see throughout all of that, and I hope I haven't muddled the waters too much, we see that Jesus is intentionally not block shooting sound bites out, but there is this beautiful continuation of thought as to why he's teaching his disciples what he's teaching. That's how a sermon should be, not like this sermon's turning out to be. Now, something I want to put before you as an image to help us see this passage of Scripture in a better light and have it put root in our minds as well as in our hearts. When you pledge allegiance here in America, I don't know why anyone outside of America would be watching this, or even outside White County, I don't know. But when you pledge allegiance, where do you put your hand? Let's say you're at the ball game. You put your hot dog down. Where does your hand go? Where did we learn to put our hand in elementary school? We put it over the left side of our upper chest. We put it over our heart to show that we are meaning what we say when we pledge allegiance, that we have pride in being an American. Did you know this? Because I didn't. Did you know that's not where our heart is? That our heart is more toward the center. That it's about the size of a fist. And so if I can illustrate, it's more here, lower and to the center, just a little bit to the left than here. Now, I didn't know that. I didn't know that. I was putting my hand not over my heart, but over lung and tissue and sinew. And well, it's silly that we do that anyway if we think too much about it, but it's symbolic. It's supposed to mean that our heart, the seat of our emotions, we are meaning this emphatically, that we will not be treasonous individuals, nor would we being in Miss So-and-so's second grade class as we say the Pledge of Allegiance. But what I'm getting at is that we didn't know where our heart was. You would think we knew where our heart was. There we have something important that's far beyond biology and anatomy. But I think we need to know where our heart is. We need to know where our spiritual heart is. I'll ask you, if you know where I'm going, where's your heart? Where is your heart? And what is at your center? If you want to tell the difference between a hypocrite and a faithful follower, one looks to who is the center of our lives. The other is who just looks self-centered. Maybe we should hold a mirror up to ourselves to see where our heart is, to see what is at our center. Again, this passage has such a vast wealth of what we can take from it. And I would pray again, as with all of these, go back and read the Sermon on the Mount. But we're cautioned to not be as the hypocrites. Unfortunately, by the account of so many people outside the church and even within, we are. That our focus is on the outside, that we might have the focus from those around us inward to ourselves, as opposed to the focus centering first with us on who is within us, Jesus Christ, who has given us the Advocate, the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, that we would honor God with our life, yet not receive acclaim, but give praise and glory to Him. And yet we do so as hypocrites, which literally means from underneath. To speak from underneath the mask that the Greek actors would wear, that it would amplify their voice, and the mask would look like the character they're playing, and it had a cone by which when they spoke it would amplify to those in the amphitheater. And so it was a direct connection and speaking of the mask that they wore. They went around the stage acting like someone, and they put on a mask to complete the illusion. My friends, it's time we took off our masks. We first must look to see who is at our center, Is it us? Have we sat upon the throne of our hearts and our life, or is Christ at the center of who we are? Secondly, we need to take our mask off. We need to quit seeking on Instagram, on Facebook, and to the world. We need to quit being shiny, fake, happy Christians. Now, if you are just that full of the joy of God, and you can't help but have that overflow into your life, then may you place that on display along with all the authenticity that comes with it, because there we find an inspiration. That there is a genuineness, because there is a genuine joy in being in Christ, along with all the storms that Christ stands by and calms, yet some still rage. That would be a beautiful thing. But may we seek to be who we are, because indeed storms rage, indeed grief tears at us, indeed legalism mars and deforms. We need to take off the mask. Why? Because Jesus is Lord and not us. This life that we have is not given to us to be used for our purposes of satisfaction. But Jesus is Lord. Jesus is still Lord when there's month left over at the end of the money. Jesus is Lord. When someone's passed away and the sorrow is real, Jesus is still Lord. When I doubted and then I see that Jesus is Lord. When I'm depressed, Jesus is Lord. I give because God gave. I pray because I'm heard. I fast that there might be more Jesus and less of me, because Jesus is Lord. Find your heart. Make it Christ's home. Take off your mask. You're not fooling anybody. And be Christ's own today. Amen. To share the good news of Jesus Christ with the world. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.